So you could broadly say that issues of human development from an individual standpoint, etc., are best done by fixing the problem. And issues of place, issues of governance, issues of systems are best addressed by fixing the system. But like I said, they are not mutually exclusive. In my view, this is one of the most complex challenges of the 21st century, both in the Indian context and the global context, fixing our cities. The city and its problems cannot be solved in a linear, analytical, technocratic manner. This is again a big distinction between the corporate world and the development sector. Each of us needs to have a theory of change about ourselves, about us as individuals, about our individual journeys as human beings.
Hello everyone. This is a first of its kind on Inspire Someone today that Srikanth is interviewing Srikanth. Yes, you heard it right. Today I have with me Srikanth Vishwanath, CEO of Janagraha. Janagraha is a Bangalore-based not-for-profit working with a mission of transforming quality of life in Indian cities and towns. Janagraha works with citizens to catalyze active citizenship in city neighborhoods and with governments. Srikanth, pleasure to have you here. Thanks for joining me today.
Likewise. Thank you for inviting me, Srikanth.
Unlike the usual trend, you kind of seem to buck the trend that you have identified to move into the development sector pretty early on in your career. Now, it's been, what, close to a decade in the development sector, Srikanth? What are the parallels one can draw with corporate and the development sector? And what's your learning through this exercise?
Wow, that's a fairly short question, but the response to which is fairly deep, one could say. If I were to summarize in the most pithy manner that I can think of, I would say that in the corporate sector, we focus a lot on what I would say are methods, which is methods of professionalism, methods of professional clinical execution of tasks and activities. And those tasks and activities are all very well-defined. And largely, the methods are also well-defined. And from your schooling and in your college and thereafter as part of, say, a program of apprenticeship or on-the-job learning in the early years in career, you're able to achieve mastery over these methods in order to achieve those well-defined ends. And those ends largely are commercial. The unit of measurement is generally returns. But of course, it would be wrong to say that every individual professional works only for monetary returns. There's also a lot of satisfaction that comes with doing the job well. The excitement of learning something new, the excitement of dealing with new challenges, working with people, etc., certainly there. But largely, globally, the credit markets measure the outcome in units of money. But compared to that, in the development sector, and I learned this quite late, I must admit, the focus on methods needs to be there, but you don't kind of overemphasize it. You emphasize a lot more in discovering the journey which takes you to the destination. Because the methods are not defined. The outcome is a, you can't say the outcome is defined. The outcome could be different in different people's heads. But you can define it as a feeling. You can define the end as an emotion. You can define the end as a vision. But the pathway to that is uncertain, is unknown. The methods to achieve it are also unknown. So in some sense, I would say the private sector is like a neatly manicured lawn, which has method and form to it, whereas the development sector is more like a jungle.
And you got to bring method to the madness.
You have to bring method to the madness. That's right.
So how does this pan out? I think from what I hear from you, there's a lot of ambiguity in the way you have to kind of deal with it when you have a problem. Not everything gets well defined. And that becomes even more critical because you are kind of leading an organization. As a CEO, how hard that becomes when you have a lot of ambiguous tasks in front of you.
That's right. Yeah. So in fact, even in our own internal performance competency framework, one of the key attributes that we look for and kind of try and nurture in our teams is dealing with ambiguity. But I want to just take a step back, Srikanth, and also clarify one aspect. So Janagraha's work is in fixing systems that create quality of life in cities. I'd like to frame the development sector as comprising two kinds of organizations. There could be organizations that are trying to fix problems, and there could be organizations that are trying to fix systems, which in turn fix problems. Now, these two kinds of organizations are not necessarily mutually exclusive. So organizations that are fixing problems may eventually end up fixing the system itself by proving how to solve the problem. An example of that could be, say, I'm just taking one name. There could be many other organizations like this, like the Akshay Patra Foundation, which is delivering meals to children in schools at scale. So there is a strong probability, if they have not already done so, that their model of solving this problem of child malnutrition, of hunger, of school attendance, etc., may eventually lead to fixing the system.
So you make a good point, kind of comparing fixing a problem to fixing the system, right? And there's a great example you kind of made between, say, what an Akshay Patra is doing and what Janagraha is trying to do. So how do you see the pros and cons of each of these approaches, and what makes most sense, or does both coexist in the development sector?
Yes. So like I said, I think it's more a function of the kind of problem that you're trying to solve, and also of one's own mindset, of one's own inspiration, and perhaps also skills and competencies, right? So I won't necessarily say that there are pros and cons for these two models. It really depends on context. The context of the problem, the context of the place, the context of the people that you're working with, etc. So I really won't say that one is better than the other. It really depends. But I would broadly generalize and say, at the risk of, you know, taking the risk of generalization, I would say that subsectors like education, skills, poverty alleviation, hunger, you know, welfare of the girl child, wherever there are individual human beings, the lives of individual human beings are being touched in a very direct manner. Those organizations, those problems, you could say, are amenable to fixing the problem and through that fixing the system. But where you're trying to influence a governance system, where you're trying to fix politics, where you're trying to fix a place, the governance of a place, you're trying to fix the place as a whole, then there, perhaps fixing the system would be more appropriate. So for example, if you're trying to ensure that your street is clean, the street outside your home is clean on a continuous basis, you're not trying to impact the life of any one person or groups of persons directly, right? You're trying to fix for the place. You're trying to fix the place. You're trying to fix infrastructure, etc. It will indirectly affect lives of everyone. It will indirectly affect public health, etc. But if you do that by directly addressing the problem, the root cause really doesn't go away. When you start identifying the root cause of why is there garbage in the first place on the street, you realize that it ends up in what is broadly known as governance. So you could broadly say that issues of human development from an individual standpoint, etc., are best done by fixing the problem. And issues of place, issues of governance, issues of systems are best addressed by fixing the system. But like I said, they are not mutually exclusive, because issues of human development ultimately will become outcomes of the system. And ultimately, when you fix the system, you want the benefits of that fixing the system to be available to the last human being standing. So in some sense, both are complementary approaches.
And also from an output standpoint, if you look at it, from a fix the problem statement standpoint, the results that you get to see is more or less instantaneous. Either you get to see the results in a week, in a month, or probably in 6 months time period. There's a systems thinking approach wouldn't get to the results probably for years together, right?
That's absolutely.
And while you have very neatly elicited it, I think from a common citizen perspective, a lot of the things looks like, okay, this will not get done. There is so much of delay. The government is kind of sitting on it, not doing anything around it. Little do we understand that, okay, this is a systems thinking issue rather than a fix-the-problem kind of a mentality, right?
That's right.
So Addressing the perception of the citizens from that standpoint, what would be your recommendation? How can citizens be better connected, better aware of what is the government doing to fix some of these things, which is more system thinking rather than fix-the-problem types?
Right. So in my view, this is one of the most complex challenges of the 21st century, both in the Indian context and the global context. Fixing our cities, fixing the problems of our cities, whether it's housing and slums, whether it's poverty, whether it's, you know, migration, skills, garbage, traffic, water supply, you name it, each of them is a complex problem. And the reason it's a complex problem is because as we are all individual citizens and families, we are people essentially, and we live in certain places, right? We have our livelihoods in certain places and we work in certain other places and we face problems. And the fact of the matter is these are complex systems challenges, each of them. Contrary to what some of us may believe sitting in our living rooms, that this arises because of corruption or inefficiency, the truth is far from it. And the reason I say it is, even when there is no corruption, or even when officials, bureaucrats and politicians are striving genuinely and sincerely, many times this problem is not getting solved. And the reason is, fundamentally, this is about governance of a place. And when you're trying to govern a place, different people have different priorities. Today, you may be facing traffic as the most pressing challenge, and you may not be worried about water, because you may be living in an apartment complex that has storage capacity, that has Kaveri connection, that has borewells as standby. But if I am living in a lower income neighborhood, or if I'm living in a slum, the principal issue that I may have is housing and water, and not necessarily traffic. Even if, assume for a moment that nobody is corrupt, nobody is inefficient, in your place, your elected representative is going to fight for solving traffic. And in my place, my elected representative is going to fight for water supply and housing. And this process is what we call politics, is how do interests of different people get represented by elected politicians, resources get allotted, and then programs get delivered so that our quality of life improves, with, of course, disproportionate focus on the urban poor and the traditionally disadvantaged sections of society. So this is why a city cannot be solved. A city and its problems cannot be solved in a linear, analytical, technocratic manner. This is, again, a big distinction between the corporate world and the development sector, where there is no linear way in which this problem can be solved, because it is inherently a complex systems problem, where there are different subsystems that have independent existence. They also interact with each other, etc. So as individual citizens, the starting point, in my view, is twofold. One is to show some kind of curiosity on why is this problem not going away, instead of generalizing that it's only because of corruption, bad politics, inefficiency, etc. So if you show some curiosity and say, let me try and find out why is this happening, that sense of curiosity is both, can be quite revealing, liberating. It's like light bulbs going off in your head. And the second piece is at a deep philosophical level to say, let me do my bit. Irrespective of whether the larger problem is going away or not, let me be a good citizen to begin with. In my home, outside on my street, and in my neighborhood. Whether it's to do with segregation of garbage, or it is to do with, you know, reducing your carbon footprint, or it is to do with conservation of water, power, etc.
And this also kind of focuses on the citizen movement, wherein you did touch upon that, these citizens getting involved in some of these elements. So how can citizens participate more in matters that impact them? And if people listening to this, if they were to say, okay, what can I change, say, starting tomorrow morning, what would that be?
That's right. Like I mentioned in my earlier response, the first place where you can make change is in your own home, is with respect to segregation of garbage. Could be with respect to composting. Could be with respect to conserving water and power, ensuring that you don't turn on your tap and allow water to run when you're brushing your teeth. Could be as small as that. And this is important. This is non-trivial in a country like India, where cities are so unequal. And we just came out of a phase when we saw the searing inequality between our fellow citizens who are migrants, right? And many other privileged communities like you and I. Therefore, this good citizenship begins at home and begins outside your home on the street, which is, you know, making sure basic citizenship behaviors like queuing up, not honking on the street, not violating traffic rules, not throwing garbage on the street, right, etc., are the basic fundamental building blocks of good citizenship. But that arises from a place of saying, it could be a place of intellectual curiosity, or could even be from a place of saying, I don't care if the rest of the world doesn't fix the problem, but I'm going to do my bit to fix it. So that's one piece of it. The second, more tangible, more, you could say, impactful way of getting engaged is to sign up and be an office bearer in your own apartment association or resident welfare association. So if you're not already a member, go and become a member of your apartment association. If you're not already a member of your resident welfare association, become a member of the resident welfare association. Start attending those meetings. Try and find out what are they doing about garbage? What are they doing about water? What are they doing about sewerage? What are they doing about rainwater harvesting? Find out about that. Start participating in meetings. So two words in response to your question. Show up.
Mm-hmm. Two simple words, and again has a greater impact both on the lives of the citizens as well as the city. Show up.
Show up. And in the last few days, I've just been thinking of the power of just showing up. Think of politicians and think of what kind of hectic schedules they run. It's because they have a compulsion of just showing up every day. They have a compulsion of showing up every day because irrespective of whether I'm a power crazy politician focused only on getting elected or I'm a sincere public service minded politician, irrespective of the two, I have an obligation, I have a compulsion to just show up day in, day out. Morning and night, you will always see the homes of councillors, MLAs, MPs and ministers milling with people, coming to them with problems, coming to them with suggestions, coming to them with complaints, coming to them with requests. So show up is the first step in being a good citizen.
Just to take a step back from where we started off, you have spent a decade in the development sector, but for a lot of the folks out there contemplating to move into the development sector, let's hear from you what has been your own challenges of transitioning into this sector. And I'm sure along with that, there are also the aha moments and why did I make this decision? So can you throw some light on that?
Oh, sure. So I'm going to keep it simple. And I'm going to say, whenever I had an open mind to the possibilities of this sector, I felt very happy and fulfilled. And whenever I came in with biases, whenever I came in with prior judgments, those were moments of doubt. Those were moments of frustration. So having an open mind has been the key. The more you open up your mind, the more fulfilling, the more impactful the journey becomes. And to the other point that you mentioned, was there an aha moment? See, frankly, in India, as our co-founders say, you throw a stone in any direction and the stone will hit a problem. We have so many problems around us, right? So I really think that there is that spark of inspiration in every citizen, in every neighborhood, in every city in India. Because there are so many problems around us. Every day, those problems are staring at us. And I think all of us understand what it could be. And we keep wondering, why is it the way it is? We all wonder that from when we are born. It's only that we have to kind of carefully nurture that spark and make it become a flame that kind of keeps burning continuously. The spark of inspiration has to become a flame of inspiration, and it can manifest itself in two ways. One is you may decide that I'm done with my career in the private sector. I have achieved my goals, or I have, you know, fulfill the aspirations I had for my professional life in the private sector. So let me now go and pursue a full-time career in the development sector. And now, more than 10 years ago, now there are plenty of opportunities in the development sector in India, where professionals who worked in the corporate sector can meaningfully transition and continue to apply their professional skills in the development sector. So you could do that, or you could volunteer. We are sitting in a city where there are hundreds of thousands of people, including job-holding professionals, who are volunteering their time either with nonprofits in their own neighborhoods or working in their chosen areas or in their own neighborhoods as part of the community, as part of resident welfare associations, as part of civic movements. Could be like Citizens for Bengaluru or as part of RWAs, or there are federations of RWAs like I Change Indiranagar or Change Makers of Kanakapura Road. I'm just naming a few of them. There are hundreds like these in different neighborhoods of Bangalore. So these are the 2-3 options that are available for working professionals in Bangalore to meaningfully contribute.
And continuing with that, do you see a change in the skill sets or the competencies required for somebody to thrive in a development sector vis-a-vis in the corporate world? Having traversed both the worlds, what's your take on that?
So I don't think so, Srikant. I don't think you need different skills. You could in some way say you may need slightly different competencies, but those competencies are not unlearnable. You don't need to do a 3-year course to learn those competencies. And it comes from what I mentioned earlier about having an open mind. If you are mission
curious,
staying curious. And I feel that in this sector, if you are mission driven, if you say at all costs, I have to undertake this journey and reach the promised land, you will always have an open mind and you'll keep adapting. And but I must say, it was kind of very revealing and enlightening to me when I joined this sector to see the kind of openness there is. This sector is completely open. It's very closely engaged with the government system. It's very closely engaged with media. You know, you meet so many more people on a daily basis doing so many different things because you're all the time trying to collaborate. You're all the time, you know, trying to figure out how is it that you can make a greater impact. And in that pursuit, you have to persuade, you have to influence, you have to engage. And therefore, you're all the time meeting people, you're talking to people. So that's a huge difference. It's not a job where you sit behind a desk. Most of the jobs in the development sector involve engaging, persuading, influencing, etc., at least from Janagraha standpoint or in the urban sector. So I would say for professionals from the corporate sector, they in fact have an advantage. They have the advantage of having mastered the methods. They tend to have very professional work ethic. They are used to working long hours. They are used to working against deadlines. They are used to working in multi-geography, multidisciplinary teams. They are savvy with technology tools. They understand the possibilities of technology. They understand how markets work, how the private sector markets work, right? How is capital raised, deployed, etc. They have a lot of advantages. The cases where there are challenges, like I said, are places where, you know, your habits have become so deeply embedded. Like, for example, you won't have all the privileges and all the systems and processes that you can take for granted in the private sector. You should be comfortable juggling many balls. Like, for example, communications is very important in the development sector. In the private sector, many of us who are not communications professionals just have to send an email to some other team and that team will handle it, right? But it's not the case in the development sector because communication is core in the development sector. So you need to understand communications to a certain extent. I'm not saying you need to become a communications professional. You need to understand the role of the media. You need to understand, maybe, I'm just giving you examples. You may need to learn how to draft a press release. You may need to learn how to organize a press conference, for example, as an example. Those are not unlearnable. If you come with an open mind and if you're able to connect this competency or this activity to the mission, then it becomes quite easy.
Got it. What are those one or two projects that you're very excited about that will change the landscape of the cities in the future?
So one of my new and senior colleagues who joined us 3 months ago, Srinivas Alavalli, he started a platform called City Politics. And the idea of City Politics is within 3 years to create a national movement of sorts where politics is no longer a bad word in cities, but politics means garbage. Politics means housing. Politics means water supply. Politics means how do citizens come together and engage with elected councillors to solve their civic problems and have a voice in civic governance in their neighborhood and in their city. So this, by far, strengthening grassroots democracy has been a core focus area for Janagraha since inception close to 2 decades ago. And this city politics, you could say, is our way of reconnecting with our own roots, ensuring that hundreds of thousands of civic leaders in different neighborhoods and different cities in India are able to connect with each other and connect with their elected councillors in the municipality to come together and strengthen the fabric of democracy in our cities. So that by far is the most exciting project that we are undertaking currently in Janagraha.
So that's very interesting. You're not only creating a movement-based kind of a platform, but you're also developing leaders in the bargain.
Yes, we really believe that unless there is massive multiplication in the number of civic leaders in our cities, we will not see transformative change. And those civic leaders will need to be both from within the communities and from within elected councils.
Okay. So Srikant, what has been the difference maker moment for you?
For me, clearly, I would say making this decision of joining Janagraha itself is easily one of the most defining moments of my life. Because the way the decision happened was very unremarkable, totally by chance. But what it has done to my understanding of democracy, of the country, of the world around me, of society, etc., I simply couldn't have imagined it in the corporate sector.
Great. And you're also a proponent of what is called as a theory of change. What is it? And if you can help all of our listeners to kind of walk them through or decipher theory of change for all of us.
Sure. It's a very commonly used jargon in the development sector. I myself learned it after joining Janagraha. So for complex systems problems, think of this analogy. Assume for a moment that you're trying to cross a jungle, and beyond that jungle lies the promised land, lies the place, you know, which is a place of everlasting happiness, a place that you've always dreamed about going to. And you need to cross that jungle to get to that dreamland, to get to that wonderland. And you don't have Google Maps with you. You don't have a clear path through that jungle, right? So what do? You begin with a hypothesis. You begin with a hypothesis of understanding whatever you're able to see of that jungle, whatever you have heard of that jungle, you come up with a certain hypothesis, right? Other people before you may have gone through that jungle, or there may be other people who have told you about the jungle, etc., who have tried and failed, who have tried and succeeded, different kinds of people. So from that and from your own observations, you accumulate a certain set of information, and based on that, you create a hypothesis. You say, okay, this is how I'm going to try and cross the jungle. You will say, I'm going to wear protective gear. I'm going to take a torchlight with me. I'm going to have a water bottle. I'm going to turn left. And then, you know, I'm going to follow these kinds of trees out of the jungle into the promised land, say, for example. Now, that hypothesis or that articulation of the steps that you will take to achieve your mission is the theory of change. The description of the journey, the articulation of the journey from where you are to where you want to go is the theory of change.
And it's applicable to anybody, in irrespective of which sector they belong to. Right? This can be personal journey, this can be corporate, absolutely, this can be absolutely the development sector.
Yes. In fact, it's been a late realization for me that each of us needs to have a theory of change about ourselves, about us as individuals, about our individual journeys as human beings. And I must say that the biggest learning for me in the last 10 years in working on an intractable big problem like fixing India's cities has been that at its core, this is a journey of self-improvement rather than a journey of trying to change the world around you. Because you realize, and my co-founders say, that if you believe that the problem that you're working on can easily be solved by you or your organization individually and within your own lifetime, then you're totally underestimating the problem. So I keep thinking of freedom fighters who gave up their lives for freedom but died in 1946 before independence. Does it mean they wasted their life because they didn't see the fruits of their labor before their eyes? No. They gave up their lives in achieving something which they were not able to enjoy. Somebody else enjoyed it, which is the nature of complex development journeys. And I think what theory of change does is it imbues you with a sense of humility. It imbues you with a sense of proportion of who you are, what you can do to yourself and what you can do to the rest of the world and the nature of the world, the nature of society, etc. Not in the sense of, you know, reconciling to a state of no change or reconciling to the current status quo, but saying that because of the nature of change, because of the nature of the world and society, you have to work with redoubled effort. What we in Janagraha called urgent patience, which is work with urgency in efforts, but be patient with the results.
Well, that's a beautiful word, urgent patience. And what basically theory of change does to you also is it gives you a tool called as your own Google Map to figure out what you want to do.
That's correct. Theory of change is a Google Maps for each of our lives. And when we close our eyes in moments of inspiration, in moments of deep reflection and contemplation about our own lives, when you close your eyes, you may reflect on the fact that you want to be a different kind of person. You may say that I want to be a different kind of person. I want to show more love to my family. I want to show my parents that I really care about them. I want to show gratitude, right? You may say that I want to become a different kind of person. I want to give more time to the people I care about, the people I love, or I want to overcome some of the vices that I may have, right? Etc. Or you may say there are new skills I want to learn. There are new competencies I want to learn. There's something deeply meaningful that I want to do which can help other people, which can touch the lives of other people, right? And then you realize that there is no Google Map for this. This is an iterative process. This is a journey where you discover the path yourself. Because your journey, nobody else has undertaken before you. Not your parents, not your children, nobody. your context is unique. And therefore, that's a fascinating journey of creating a theory of change for yourself, because you're discovering the path by undertaking the journey and not before it. Therefore, there are learnings during the path. Every day is a learning process, and you keep informing your theory of change and reinforming your theory of change. So the theory of change doesn't remain the same. It's a dynamic theory.
Beautiful. I think that gives everybody a great takeaway to have to focus on the theory of change, which is unique, and that definitely gives them the direction for their own life journeys. So Srikant, this is something that we do on Inspire Someone Today, which is ask all of our guests to pick a title of a book if it were to be made as a memoir for them.
Let me say, in some other context, I had thought of this as the title of a book. I would say The Escape from Mediocrity, because I genuinely believe, like I said, in what Swami Vivekananda beautifully described as the substance of Vedanta, which is that each soul is potentially divine, right? And in his own pithy words, he said, each soul is potentially divine. And the aim of life is to discover that divinity within. You know, if you apply it in a slightly more simple way to our own lives, it essentially means we are not just destined to hold jobs in companies or jobs in offices. Along with holding jobs, along with doing your employment in order to earn a living and support your families, listen to your inner voice, nurture that spark within you and make that spark a flame. Nurture that inner voice, you know, to become a melody that, you know, that lasts during your full lifetime. Don't give up on the aspirations. Don't give up on the dreams. Don't give up on soaring, elevating, inspiring feelings that each of us has had when we were in school, when we were in college. That fire of idealism where we thought that the world has to be different, the world has to be a better place, and that we can do something about it. There's no need to give that up just because, you know, you had to start earning by a certain age to support your parents or to support yourself, and thereafter to support your family, irrespective of whether you're a man or a woman. We don't have to give up on those. We live in a world where you can, in a meaningful way, listen to that inner voice and follow it. And for me, that journey is the escape from mediocrity, where you don't become complacent because you've got a job, but you kind of rekindle that fire of idealism from your youth, and then you pursue it.
Super. I think that's a great book to have against your name, Escape from Mediocrity. So Srikant, if we were to have a Inspire Someone Today message for all the listeners out there, what's that Inspire Someone Today message from you?
So the tagline for Janagraha when we launched was essentially a re-articulation of what Mahatma Gandhi said, because Janagraha itself is a play on the words Satyagraha. Therefore, the tagline was, be the change you want to see. And I want to just tell everyone listening to this that these are not words of empty idealism. In a city, in a neighborhood, on a street, in your home, you literally can be the change that you want to see around you. With small daily actions, you can begin with one act of good citizenship, and that also contributes to changing the world around you. So don't wait. Start today. Start now.
Excellent. Thank you so much for joining and sharing the pulse of wisdom.
Thank you for having me on your show, Srikant. Thank you.
Thank you for listening into today's edition of Inspire Someone Today. It's been a privilege to bring in these conversations. If you like this episode and have any feedback or comments, do mail me at inspiresomeonetodaypodcast@gmail.com. Inspiring someone is like creating ripples around us. If you like what to listen, feel free to share them and let's create ripples of inspiration. Do not forget to follow me on my Instagram handle @InspireSomeoneTodayPodcast for all the latest updates. This is Srikant, your host, signing off, and until next time, keep inspiring.